Hello and welcome to A Picture in a Thousand Words. I'm Michael Fiedler. This one, Neutrophil to Lymphocyte Ratio, Chapter 4, dun dun dun, the conclusion. So for those that are still on this train, and I doubt there are many, this is it. This is the so what. This is sort of like what this half-baked idea of mine can mean in black and white. So just to recap the previous three real quickly, the first chapter goes into a very all-encompassing look at neutrophil lymphocyte ratio and a potential feel-good effect from a drug called Tysabri or natalizumab. Chapter two gives you data to that effect. It's got a little more graphs and p-values and such. Chapter three is more of an unpacking of NLR outside of multiple sclerosis and Tysabri to give you a sense of what that means as a marker. And what you're looking at now is a potential label update. So if I wasn't eccentric enough, we're gonna change how this drug is used in clinical practice. A little bit on how a label works. Essentially, what a product label is, in the U.S. it's called the U.S. prescribing. It's called the prescribing information for a drug. It's on every drugs. If you type a drug.com, it will be on that website. It comes in the package if you buy it, take it home. And the equivalent document in Europe is called the summary product characteristics, and there's also regional in like Australia and Canada, they have their kind of their own equivalents, but these are sort of the two main regulatory documents that a drug is supported and how it's used, particularly NMS, which is big in Europe and the US, and it dictates what a company can say on behalf of the drug. It's sort of what they're obligated to say, what they're allowed to say, the first third of what the image that you're looking at is the specific language from the U.S. prescribing information. I'll go through it in a second. But then the middle portion is the same language from the EU summary of product characteristics. And the bottom language is some language of my own. Back to the purpose of a label is that it really establishes the playbook that a company can, what they can say about it proactively. So if you say something that your drug can do something, if it's in your label, then you can like put it in a television commercial, for example. If it's not in your label, you cannot. And that's called off-label. Now, if a physician is curious about something, they want to know a detail about your drug that isn't specifically called out, like how it performs in a certain patient segment, like African-Americans or older individuals, then they can send out what's called a medical science liaison. They can have a reactive conversation and you can talk about things that are not on the label, but you can't communicate those things proactively. So that's sort of, the label sets it's the Bible for a drug that a company can use to promote it. So the language that's highlighted in both documents, but just starting with the U.S. prescribing information, is in clinical trials, Tysabri was observed to induce increases in circulating lymphocytes, and then the other language that's highlighted is elevations of neutrophils were not observed. There's a lot of other stuff in there, but I don't want to go on too many tangents. The point being is that, ironically, they're sort of inverted, but if you took that elevations of neutrophils above it, it's not that portion of a fraction is not changing, and you get an increase in lymphocytes. If you could put that number below it and you had a fixed numerator but an expanding denominator, if you took fractions, the bigger the number, the bottom number gets, the smaller the actual number gets. So the ratio is going to come down just by fourth grade math. And the same thing goes for what's in the EU summary product characteristics. In a two-year controlled clinical trials in MS patients, Tysabri treatment was associated with increases in circulating lymphocytes. There are other cell types, but for the purposes of this, I just want to focus on them, and elevations in neutrophils were not seen. Same essential language. And if you do the math, you'll see an analysis, and this is sort of what my proposed language is, which is analysis of clinical trial data indicate that compared to placebo, Tysabri reduced neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio. That's, I think, a defensible claim based on what's already in the prescribing information and summary product characteristics. And that dot, dot, dot by approximately 40% is sort of a call out to the difference between the USPI and the summary product characteristics. So there's sort of that blank space underneath the paragraph in the summary product characteristics. I actually covered something up so it looks cleaner, but this effects on laboratory tests is much longer in the EU summary product characteristics. The EU summary product characteristics oftentimes is more inclusive of information and has a lot more stuff in it. It also has things on extended interval dosing, which is a way you can kind of cut the amount of Tysabri that you're putting in your body and offset your risk of PML, which is its sort of big safety hangup. And it also has stuff on JCV index, or JC, John Cunningham Virus Index, which is also a risk marker for PML, those things are limited or non-existent in the US prescribing information. This is it for laboratory test abnormalities. And what's interesting about it is that it's titled laboratory test abnormalities. So it's already in the frame of a anomaly or essentially an adverse event. And that's kind of what I think my obstacle with this has been, is that like when you bring up these cell types and the changes that are happening in people on Tysabri, their mind immediately goes to a safety risk, which is understandable. And that's what the language, especially in the USPI, is just trying to create a sense of comfort that they are, they can go up, but they're reversible. If you look at the effects on laboratory tests in the EU summary product characteristics, it has an increases from baseline for lymphocytes, monocytes, eosinophils, and basophils range from 35% to 140% for individual cell types, but mean cell counts remain within normal ranges. As an example of more granular information on this particular topic, but I call that out because the reason why I have the approximately 40% in the bottom is that you could conceivably have this in the, this is like EU SMPC friendly, where the USPI, you may only be able to get away with what's in the first two lines. And there'd probably be more language as well, like median this and number of patients or whatever kind of additional wrapping that it would require. But distilling it as crystalline as I can, it's what it does. It will reduce neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio. And sort of as a branch point away from Tysabri and just focusing on NLR, and why I think this is important is that, you know, even let's just take off the table that it has a clinical effect, it causes a feel-good effect. Let's say it doesn't do that. NLR itself is a very powerful marker. It you know, think of it like an insulin or a amyloid beta levels. Like it's something that it's a number that's relevant. And just in 2020 alone, there have been 77 papers published on neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio related to COVID. So just COVID. And there have probably been over 2,000 papers on NLR in general, but it's really blown up in the last 7 years, and it's relevant for things as critical as COVID. And because it's a relationship between the innate and the adaptive immune system, it really boils it down. And those are two very complicated bodies. And actually, as a personal edit that I wanted to call out, is that I mistakenly lumped natural killer cells into the adaptive immune system in some previous episodes, and it's actually in the innate immune system. But either way, neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio kind of boils down your immune system to a very refined number. And that number is very important and predictive of bad stuff. And what's interesting is that in the normal ranges, language is particularly interesting because the normal ranges for these cell types is quite wide. So for neutrophils, you can be normal in air quotes, but you can be between, it's something along the lines of like 2,500 to 8,000 cells per square millimeter whatever the unit would be. But it's 2,500 to 8,000. Lymphocytes, it's like 1,000 to 4,000. So you're talking about, like, imagine those are speed limits. Like, the speed limit range is between 25 and 80. That's quite a range. Or between 10 miles an hour and 40 miles an hour. It's quite a range. So somebody can have their neutrophil counts double and still be, in air quotes, normal ranges, or halved for their lymphocytes. And you're just looking at the numbers in a vacuum is not going to tell you that anything is wrong. But your neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio will change dramatically if you have those types of jumps, even if it's something that's not occurring, even if the cell numbers stay within normal ranges. So as a clinical marker, I think it is really powerful. And Tysabri already has the stuff to drive it. I have an appreciation that it's probably not going to happen. I don't expect Biogen to be like, you know what, you sold me, I'm going to do it. It takes years to change labels, and I totally understand that. But what I also think is interesting is that there is some competition for natalizumab. There's a biosimilar coming up through a company called Sandoz, which is owned by Novartis. And they're making a natalizumab biosimilar, so maybe they want to put it in their label. I don't know if they'd actually be that all interested either, because the issue in both camps is trying to communicate this in a franchise setting. So Tysabri is not the only drug that Biogen has. I don't know if Sandoz has any other MS drugs, but Novartis certainly does. And one of them is called Gilenya. And I don't think the story for Gilenya and NLR will be favorable. I think it will increase your NLR because your circulating lymphocytes go way down. So what is good for the goose is not always good for the gander. And it's a similar but not as complex, but more complicated yet not as serious story for Tecfidera, which is Biogen's oral and their real moneymaker, because that patients on Tecfidera can also have reductions in their lymphocyte counts, but it's not as not nearly as robust as Gilenya is. So, but in either camp, so NLR won't hurt it, but it likely won't help it either. So this kind of effort would do well for Tysabri, but will it help anybody else in the brand? Probably in the organization, another brand, probably not. But that's kind of been Tysabri's story from the very beginning. It has done this on a number of fronts. It is this groundbreaker. It is this amazing drug. And I will include a link to a video of a guy named Gavin Giovannone, who's somebody I really respect intellectually, telling a similar narrative about natalizumab. It's such a transformative molecule that has taught us so much about everything. And I think that NLR is a window into a whole different way of looking at the immune system. Or I wouldn't say different, but it's a whole new, you know, think of it like a wavelength spectrum that we never saw before. And there is plenty of data to chew up. And, you know, the label language, the reason why it's so simple is because you don't need to go after any of it. There's no new trials. You don't have to do any new studies. You have everything you need for it. And so then why do this, right? Like, no one's going to really change anything. And for me, it really is a demonstration of intellectual competence as a professional. I'm a very smart person, and I like to, and I'm not smart in the sense of like I have a high IQ, but I can sniff out solutions. And I was asked to uncover something, and I found something. And that's just how it's woven together. And this is the only way I can get out of my head. but it's been a swell journey. I hope that it is now over. I think it's as black and white as I've made the point as crystal clear as I possibly can. And we'll see where it goes from here. Anyway, I hope everybody's safe and healthy out there.